Dr. Collins, why don't we go to you and tell us how the remarkable progress that we've seen, that Walter writes about over this year, over the past several years, will change our lives and change our future.
Well, thanks for the chance to be on and talk about this, because this is really a remarkable time in biotechnology, the invention of these approaches to be able to understand how to read and sometimes how to write the genome. People should think of the genome as an instruction book. That's a pretty good metaphor. You have one, all of you listening. It's about 3 billion letters long, written in this strange language that has just 4 letters in its alphabet. And we used the Human Genome Project to read that out for the first time, and your individual genomes can now be read out in the space of a day or two for less than $1,000, which is pretty amazing to be able to say. But if you really want to understand the role of DNA in disease risks and how to do something about that, you not only want to read it, you want to be able to do a find and replace if there's something there that's not quite what it would be for good health. And that's what CRISPR-Cas has made it possible to do. And you mentioned, Walter, the curing of a patient with sickle cell disease using CRISPR-Cas in this last year. That's a pretty amazing milestone. So I would also say CRISPR has a lot of other applications, even including COVID-19. Some of the most exciting new technologies for detecting the presence of the virus depend on CRISPR, because it's also a really good way to find a certain stretch of RNA letters in a complicated mixture, like a nasal swab. So the applications, I think we still are just scratching the surface of what they could be.
So interesting. Dr. Collins, it's Willie Geist. Good morning. We've been talking this week around Walter's book also about some of the ethical concerns about the application of CRISPR, and I know you share some of those concerns. One of the first projects that was put on display in Hong Kong, you called deeply disturbing and irresponsible. So what are your concerns about the use of this technology on humans?
I am deeply concerned about utilizing this to alter the heritable part of the DNA genome that would be passed on to future generations. First of all, there are no compelling medical circumstances where we really need to do that. And second of all, this starts us into a pathway that I think most of us are deeply concerned about in terms of changing the very essence of our own biology without quite knowing what we're doing. This has serious risks in terms of unexpected consequences. And frankly, it has deeply significant philosophical and even theological consequences that we're going to somehow reinvent ourselves, which assumes that we know what would make us better than we are. So I'm in the majority, the vast majority of people saying we should not be utilizing this kind of gene editing on the heritable part of the genome. That being said, if it's the opportunity to do something like cure sickle cell disease, where you're changing the DNA in some bone marrow cells for the benefit of that patient, I'm totally excited about that. We just have to keep really clearly in mind which kind of application we're talking about, and then the ethical principles become quite clear.
April, I have to point to the fact, given that you've got a future ahead of you in science and there are gender disparities in the sciences, what this all means to you, especially the Nobel Prize ultimately.
Oh gosh, it's so inspiring to see, you know, amazing women scientists like Jennifer Doudna and Emmanuelle Charpentier be recognized by all these huge honors. But I think it needs to be said that they are very few and far between, these types of examples. And there's still, you know, so many barriers to be overcome by women scientists, from everything from just seeing a role model that looks like you to actually being able to achieve the types of things that these women have done. And so I think really, you know, there's problems at every level that are holding women back. And this isn't just a women problem. This is also true of underrepresented scientists from all different backgrounds. And you know, there are biases at many different stages of the process that need to be tackled in order for us to really have equal footing and be able to add our expertise and our creativity to the process.
Walter.
Yeah, I'd love to ask Dr. Collins something, because he just said the theological implications of making inheritable changes to our genome. One of my favorite books is yours, Dr. Collins, The Language of God. You're a practicing Christian. You have you're a person of deep faith. And what do you say to people, because you say science and religion can be reconciled in that book, what do you say to people who say we shouldn't do anything like this because it's, quote, playing God?
Well, I do believe that manipulating the very essence of our biological instruction book, the genome, in a way that would be passed on to generations is crossing that line that we don't have the wisdom to take on. And so in that regard, as a believer who sees creation as something that God has given us as a gift, and that we are, in fact, in the image of God, as the Bible would say, we ought to take with great seriousness any efforts to try to change that and become somehow a new species. That troubles me. That causes me a great deal of concern in terms of not only what the scientific risks that we might be taking, but also what does it mean about who we really are? And I think many people of faith would share that same concern.
Hey, thanks so much for watching our YouTube channel. You can follow up on today's top stories and breaking news, or catch up on your favorite MSNBC shows all in one place. Download the NBC News app today.